he had with Birmingham jazz legend Frank Doc Adams just a few weeks before his death. We will also walk through Freedom Park, a sculpture garden that pays homage to the actors in the civil rights movement, and we'll learn how courage and perseverance finally defeated segregation. We will also shine a destination spotlight on Rio de Janeiro. If you want more travel experiences beyond this radio show, we invite you to visit our website, worldfootprints.com, where you can peruse our library of radio shows, articles, and more. You can also find links to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram.
Downtown Birmingham is the home to the Civil Rights Heritage Trail. Kelly Ingrham Park, also known as Freedom Park, was the staging area for many of the demonstrations that took place in Birmingham, led by Dr. Martin Luther King, Reverend Fred Shuttlesworth, and others. Historian Barry McNeely takes us through the sculpture garden that today pays homage to all of the civil rights actors and helps keep this dark time in history alive.
We're now entering Kelly Ingrham Park from the 6th Avenue North, 16th Street side. This would have been the entrance that would have been most associated with the civil rights movement because, of course, as the young people left the doors of St. Paul's Methodist Church and the 16th Street Baptist Church, they were confronted by a phalanx of police officers and firefighters under the direction of Bull Connor. As they came out into the hundreds and the thousands, they spilled over into this park, and this park became a battleground as well on D-Day, which was May 2nd, 1963. Now, when we start talking about D-Day, these young people came out to these churches. They left those churches as they came through various different routes. Some of these young people who left those churches headed towards this park. Some of the people headed towards the lunch counters downtown. Some of the people headed towards the municipal district and the Jefferson County Courthouse. They even took different routes. Some of the teenagers were told, don't go out of the church doors at all. You stay back. We're going to send you out of the rear doors of the churches. We're going to send you away from the demonstrations, let you get to other areas downtown, and then you can demonstrate. So while Fred Shuttlesworth is standing on the stairs of the 16th Street Baptist Church, Bull Connor orders the fire department to direct their hoses on the church stairs and to hit Fred Shuttlesworth. Fred Shuttlesworth was never a very big man at all. Those hoses, they hit him, and they pick him up, and they bounce him against the stairs of the 16th Street Baptist Church with such force that he has to be hospitalized with internal injuries to his ribs. Yet the demonstrators do not give up. They're not deterred. They still keep coming in significant numbers. But these water hoses are going to be seen not just in Birmingham, not just in Alabama. The use of these water hoses is going to be seen around the globe. And this is going to cause people to weigh in on this battle that's going on in the city of Birmingham, Alabama.
This is World Footprints Radio with Ian and Tanya Fitzpatrick. We are walking through Birmingham's Freedom Park and revisiting the struggles of the civil rights movement with historian Barry McNeely. Visit worldfootprints.com for more information about Birmingham's Heritage Trail.
Now, the next thing we stop at as we walk through this park, and I should mention, this walk that we're walking on as a part of the new design of this park, it's been dubbed as Freedom Walk. But the next thing we encounter on Freedom Walk is we encounter a horse chestnut tree. This horse chestnut tree has been planted here, and it has this plaque here to represent the idea that this is dedicated to Anne Frank, but not just to Anne Frank. In a larger sense, this is dedicated to what took place during the Nazi occupation in World War II in Europe. When we start to consider this, we have to consider that Adolf Hitler sent agents to the United States of America to study the Jim Crow South. And what he does with that study is he has a group of laws created known as the Nuremberg Laws that are going to marginalize Jewish people under his control. If you consider it was illegal in the American South for an African American to marry a Caucasian, in Germany it becomes illegal for a Jewish person to be married to a person who is Aryan or German. And it reminds us that this is not a story about black versus white. This is a story about man's ability to be inhumane to other men. And that story could be seen in Rwanda. That story could be seen in Cambodia. That story could be seen in Bosnia. That story could be seen right here in the streets of Birmingham, Alabama. As we walk down Freedom Walk, if you look over to your left, by the 17th Street entrance to the park, you see a large stone. That large stone is affixed there, and it carries the name of Kelly Ingrham, who this park is named after today. This park was originally named West Park as a part of a publicity stunt to try to get the city to build itself around the western area as far as the industrialists saw the city of Birmingham. Well, after World War II is over, they renamed West Park in honor of Kelly Osmond Ingrham, who was the first Alabamian to be killed in World War I. Now, the interesting thing about that is this park is very well associated with African American history and the Civil Rights Movement. Well, when they began to talk about outfitting this park with the memorials that we see today, some people also voiced the idea that they should change the name of the park to be more representative of its African American heritage. Well, they left the park in terms of validity. They left it named Kelly Ingrham. But if we look directly to the opposite side of the park, we see memorials that are dedicated to notable African Americans from Birmingham. One of those African Americans is a lady by the name of Carrie A. Tuggle. She is the mother of black education in Birmingham, Alabama. She founded the first orphanage for black boys in this city. After a while, her orphanage became known as the Tuggle Institute. And the Tuggle Institute became the first elementary school for African Americans in this city. Another person that is memorialized in that corner is a man by the name of Julius Ellsbury. And Julius Ellsbury is the first African American killed from Birmingham in World War II. As we continue to walk through Freedom Walk, we come to another memorial, and this exhibition is dedicated to the young people who were arrested. And as we see, as we step inside, we see text. We see two children standing here, and they're standing above a statement. And the statement simply says, defiantly says, "I ain't afraid of your jail." Now, opposite them and upside down, we see the phrase, "Segregation is a sin." And what we can say about these young people is that they turn the jails in the city of Birmingham, Alabama, upside down.
To explore Birmingham's Heritage Trail through the 4th Avenue North District, an area where segregation once made it Birmingham's Little Harlem, visit heritagetrail.birminghamal.gov. You can also Google Kelly Ingrham Park or visit this show page at worldfootprints.com for relevant links.
In this destination spotlight, we continue our focus on Rio de Janeiro with Michael Nagy at the New York Times Travel Show, where we learn about the sporting and adventure activities we can find in the region.
Now, you're not from Brazil initially.
I am originally, but my family is. I was just born somewhere else, but I'm Brazilian. I was born in South Africa.
Another one of our favorite countries. That's,
what a beautiful place. I mean, if you think of Cape Town, it's the smaller version of Rio, but we're much better. they've only got Table Mountain and sharks. We don't have sharks, so you can come to us. And obviously, if you're a surfer, if you're a sailor, it's all there. I mean, a photographer once said to me, the problem with Rio is wherever you put your camera, you've got a shot. And it really is, it's very eye-catching, this mix of the green and the blue. And it's a cosmopolitan city. I mean, Rio is not a resort destination. It is a cosmopolitan city with fantastic beaches, and it's an urban resort at your disposal. And anything and whoever you want to be, you can be in Rio and Brazil, really. And the Brazilians, I mean, they really like receiving. We're very hospitable people, and they will always make you feel great. I mean, if anybody saw the World Cup, you all know that we're good at what we do in football, but we're also good at receiving people. And it was considered the World Cup of all World Cups, and with no doubt the Olympics will be the Olympics of the millennium once we have it there.
We're looking forward to going.
Well, I look forward to seeing you there. And it's not only Rio. I mean, you've got Iguazu, Salvador, Brasilia, Manaus. I mean, there's something for everybody. You want the cold, you go to the south of Brazil. You want the warmth, you've got Rio, you've got everything. But Rio is the postcard of Brazil. There's over 257 different ways of getting from the U.S. to Brazil in flights. So you can fly into Rio or through São Paulo, through Manaus. So it's all available, whatever you want to do. It's easy to get to Rio. Rio's cheap. Come. And Brazil's open arms waiting for you. But come to Rio first.
Michael, thank you.
It's a pleasure, Tanya.
We were honored to spend time with legendary Birmingham musician and educator, Dr. Frank Adams, during our visit to the Alabama Jazz Hall of Fame. This visit occurred just a few weeks before Frank Doc Adams, as he was affectionately called, passed away at age 86. A charter member of the Jazz Hall of Fame, he was inducted in 1978. Doc loved to play the sax and clarinet. He loved to teach, and he loved sharing stories from performing with some of the greatest names in jazz, such as Duke Ellington. We are pleased to share Doc's stories and some of his music during what turned out to be one of his last tours and musical sets.
I just played it for you all, because a lot of times when you're out traveling, you learn a lot of things, and you might have some good blessings if you hear a chase song. That's why I did that for you. Because evidently, you're traveling back and forth. And see, I'm so glad I didn't just see you. And where are you from? Phoenix. Phoenix, Arizona, wow!
I remember going to all those places when I was young, so you know, I traveled with Duke Ellington's band for a while, a lot of others, you know.
Jazz music, and I try to explain something to them. But I had some wonderful experiences in life. In fact, they all called me Doc. I finished Harvard University back, I can't think what year it was now. But it was in the 50s, 40s, in the 40s. In 49, I think I finished there. I had the experience of meeting some people from Utah and all of your places, because they were very smart people, and they came to Howard University, the biggest black recognized school in the world.
You're listening to World Footprints Radio with Ian and Tanya Fitzpatrick, and we are revisiting our time with legendary jazz musician Doc Adams at the Alabama Jazz Hall of Fame. Visit jazzhall.com to continue your travels through the Jazz Hall of Fame, or visit worldfootprints.com for more information.
And I was in my, just about in my 17th birthday, I hadn't finished school. And he said, they tell me you can do this. I said, what is it? And they told me what it was. that they had worn out the original carpets